we remain standing for the national anthem of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago. Your Excellency, Paula May Weeks, ORTT, President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, the Honorable Chief Justice, Mr. Justice Ivor Archie, Chief Justice of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Denise Rodriguez Archie, members of the Cabinet and other members of Parliament of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, Your Excellencies, the heads of mission and representatives of the Diplomatic Corps, Honorable Justices of Appeal, Judges and Masters and Judicial Officers of the Supreme Court of Trinidad and Tobago, Professor Rosemary Bell Antwine, Dean of the Faculty of Law of the University of the West Indies and featured speaker, members of the Superior Courts of Record of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, the Chief Magistrate and other magistrates of the Magistracy, heads and representatives of religious bodies and international organizations, other representatives of the legal fraternity, distinguished representatives of the public and private sectors, members of the court administration of the judiciary, other specially invited guests, ladies and gentlemen, good morning and welcome to the Cathedral Church of the Holy Trinity and to this service of divine worship to mark the opening of the 2019-2020 Law Term. And we pray that this worship will be an inspiration to you and that you will have a productive and fruitful term. Let us pray. Almighty and eternal, highest on high, the light of the world, the merciful, compassionate, caring and loving God, we seek your divine presence amongst us this morning at this interfaith service of worship of the ceremonial opening of the 2019-2020 Law Term. Bless the Chief Justice, the judges, and all connected with the administration of justice in the country. We ask you to guide and protect them all. Continue to give them the health, strength, and vision to do all things right to the satisfaction of our nation. Show them the path of righteousness so that they will be guided in their judgments and decisions. Bless their families and all members of staff, Father God. You are ever present in all our relationships. You are the remover of sorrow and the bestower of happiness. May your divine light continue to shine over their places of work for safety and protection, so that they can perform their duties without fear or favor. Holy God, we seek your forgiveness of any mistakes that have been made in the past. We give thanks for all that you have bestowed upon us and seek your eternal presence. Bless those who have served this administration and are not with us today. May your light continue to be with them now and in the hereafter. May we all receive comfort and solace in your love, power, and light. For these we thank you. Amen. And so I invite us now to be seated We will have a musical interlude, and then we will continue without announcement as far as it is possible. If there are to be any announcements or prompts, they will be made by the Bishop of Trinidad and Tobago, the Right Reverend Claude Berkeley.
Sakshat Param Brahma, Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha, Om Vakratunda Mahakaya, Koti Surya Sama Prabha, Nirvignam Guru Medeva, Sarvakayeshu Sarvada, Om Shanti, 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 Hari Om. Salutations to that noble teacher, who is Brahma, Vishnu and Shiva, and who is verily the Supreme Being. O Lord Ganesh, possessor of a bent trunk and a huge body, whose brilliance is equivalent to a million suns, I pray that you remove all obstacles which we may encounter in all our activities.
In the text, Baha'i's teaching on spiritual reality, it is stated, "Think not that we have revealed unto you a mere code of laws. Nay, rather, we have unsealed the choice wine with the fingers of might and power. To this bear it witness, that which the pen of revelation has revealed. Meditate upon this, O men of insight. Well is it with them that have fulfilled that which is prescribed in the book of God. It is incumbent upon everyone to observe that which God has purposed, for whatsoever has been set forth in the book by the pen of glory is an effective means of purging the purification and sanctification of the soul of men, and a source of prosperity and blessing. Happy are they that have observed his commandments. The laws of God are not imposition of will or of power or pleasure, but the resolution of truth, reason, and justice. O thou kind Lord, thou hast created all humanity from the same stock. Thou hast decreed that all shall belong to the same household. In thy holy presence they are thy servants, and all mankind are sheltered beneath thy tabernacle. All are gathered at the table of bounty, all are illumined to the light of thy providence. O God, thou kind to all, thou hast provided for all, thou hast sheltered all, confer life upon all. Thou hast endowed each and all with talents and faculties, and all are submerged in the ocean of thy mercy. O thou kind Father, unite all. Let the religions agree and make the nations one, so that they may see each other as one family and the whole earth as one home. May they live together in perfect harmony. O God, raise aloft the banner of the oneness of mankind. O God, establish the most great peace. Cement thou, O God, hearts together. O thou, kind Father, God, gladden our hearts to the fragrance of thy love. Brighten our eyes to the light of thy guidance. Delight our ears with the melody of thy words. And shelter us in the stronghold of thy providence. Thou art mighty and powerful. Thou art the giving and thou art the one who overlooketh the shortcomings of all mankind.
Assalamu alaikum. A'uzu billahi minash shaitani rajim. Bismillahi rahmani rahim. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahmani rahim. Maliki yawmiddin. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'in. Ihdinas siratal mustaqim. Siratal ladhina an'amta alayhim. Khairil maktubi alayhim waladwalin. Amen. In the name of Allah, the most gracious, the most merciful. Praise be to Allah, Lord of the worlds, the beneficent, the merciful, master of the day of judgment. You alone we worship, and to you alone we turn for help. Guide us on the straight path, the path of those whom you have favored, and not the path of those who earned your anger or who went astray. Amen. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. May you bestow peace and blessings upon the Holy Prophet Muhammad. Quran, Surah 4, verse 58. Inna Allaha ya'murukum an tu'addul amanati illa ahliha wa iza hakamtum bainan nasi an tahkumu bil adl. Inna Allaha ni'ma ya'izukum bihi. Anna Allaha kani sami'an basira. Behold, God bids you to deliver all that you have been entrusted with unto those who are entitled thereto. And whenever you judge between people, you judge with justice. Asbahna wa asbahal mulku lillah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illallah, wahdahu la sharika lah, lahu mulku wa lahul hamd, wa huwa la kulli shay'in kadir. Rabbi as-saluka khayru ma fi hazal yawm wa khayru ma ba'da wa a'udhu bika min sharri min hazal yawm wa sharri ma ba'da. O Almighty God, we have entered a new day, and with it all dominion is yours. Praise be to you, Lord of all that exist. My Lord, I ask you for the goodness of this day, its victory, its help, its light, its blessings, and its guidance, and of the days that come after it. I seek refuge in you from the evil of this day and of the days that come after it. O Allah, as we enter this new autumn, May he grant us the ability to judge fairly between all people, free from prejudice, compromise, pressure, fear, or greed. May we fear no person but only you, our Lord, the conclusive of all judges. Help us to restore peace to the conflicts with justice and equality. Increase us in knowledge, O Lord, who taught man what he knew not. Keep us from arrogance and guide us to be kind to the fortunate and the needy alike. And may you help us to do righteous deeds. Amen. Assalamu alaikum. May peace be unto you.
A pleasant morning to all. All the protocols observed. Ibawo, I pay homage. Iba olo dumare. Iba oron mila. Iba koda. Iba sheda. Iba baba. Awon baba. Iba wa ye ye. Iba yeshu. Iba onile. Iba bogo egin. Iba bogo imale. Iba bogo orisha. Iba bogo babalawo ati ifa. Ianifa. Iba bogo babalorisha ati yerorisha. Okbe mi fu olorun. Mo ogun meri aye ibase ila orun ibase iwo orun ibase ariwa ibase gusu ashe iba I pay homage to the president of our republic. I bid Iba to the ministers of government that are here. I bid Iba to the chief justice, the members of the judiciary. I give Iba, I pay homage to the members of the IRO, led by Canon Nolly Clark. I bid Iba to the entire judiciary and all members, all people gathered under this roof. I pay homage humbly to you, Ashe. Eshu Pelewu Okarama, Ayan Karata, Wo Lejo, Oyin Sheshe, Shegiri, Alagbara, Olofi, Apigalu, Amoni Shegun, Mako Ashe. Is your divine messenger, I call you by your praise names on behalf of all those joined in these proceedings. Open the way and take our prayers to the heavenly realm without delay or hindrances. Ogunwo, chief of strength, owner of power, I salute you. Remove any obstacles to our prayers reaching the heavenly realm. Ochosio, spirit of the tracker, with the speed and accuracy of the bow and arrow, take our prayers and petitions to the heavenly realm. Oshun, spirit of the river, mother of compassion, I call on you to cleanse and refresh us inside out as we gather here to join our prayers and petitions. Orun Miller, Elerikpi, Ibikeji Dumare, infinite in knowledge, grant us wisdom in the application of our knowledge. Humble our spirits and bless us to know how to carry out our work with the greatest of humanity. Onile, the owner of the earth, or as we say, the mother of the earth that we inhabit, May we understand fairness and the responsibility to maintain balance in this land. We hear your rumblings, and we thank you for preserving our lives. May we never incur your wrath. We say, we must give respect to the earth. May your bright light illuminate our path and guide us to the best resolutions in the capacities in which we serve. Guardian of the character of women, take your rightful place among us. Bestow the blessings of leadership among the women fit and deserving to serve in this profession, to lead in the delivery of service with compassion and patience, respecting the dignity of all. Great Shango Kabiesi, Spirit of Lightning, Pursuer of Justice, give us the courage to stand up and stand apart if and when necessary. Kabiesi, Shango. Oya, Spirit of the Wind, may the winds of earth and heaven bring us positive transformation in the shortest possible time. Yemoja, the mother of the seven seas. Ashere, Yami, Alateo, Yemoja, Asa Ayabi, Olokun. Olokuno, may your wealth be reflected in the wisdom that informs our leadership. Benevolent ancestors, we thank you for your presence and your protection. Guide us to do the best for our children in the justice system. May we treat with them in a way that strengthens our families. Ashe, Ashe, Ashe.
A reading from the book of Malachi, chapter 4, verses 1 and 2. For behold, the day cometh that shall burn as an oven, and all the proud, yes, all that do wickedly shall be stubble, and the day that cometh shall burn them up, saith the Lord of hosts, that it shall leave them neither root nor branch. But unto you that fear my name shall the Son of Righteousness arise with healing in his wings, and you shall go forth as calves of the stall. Let us bow our heads in prayer. Kind and loving Heavenly Father, we approach your throne of grace in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus, and we borrow the words of the songwriter Charles Wesley. Christ, whose glory fills the skies, Christ, the true, the only light, Son of Righteousness, arise, triumph o'er the shades of night. Dayspring from on high be near, day star in my heart appear. Lord, we implore you, as the Son of Righteousness, to shine your healing rays into our land. May you arise over our mountain ranges. May your light flood our plains and fill our valleys. May you, Lord Jesus, enter every dark crevice and dispel the darkness of crime, corruption, and injustice in our land. May you, Lord Jesus, impart healing and wholeness to our people, wisdom and insight to our leaders, and righteousness justice and peace to all. We ask this, Lord, of your heavenly Father, in your holy name. Amen.
Your Excellency, Olumi Weeks, ORTT, President of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, the Honorable Chief Justice, Mr. Justice Ivor Archie, Chief Justice of the Republic of Trinidad and Tobago, and Mrs. Denise Rodriguez Archie, kindly permit me to adopt the protocols established at the beginning, so ably done by the Dean during the time of welcome, and allow me to say good morning to you all. Permit me once again to join the Dean in welcoming you to the Cathedral Church of the Holy Trinity on the auspicious occasion of the opening of the law term 2019. Be assured of our prayers and our best wishes as we strive to dispense justice in our various capacities and roles in this blessed republic. This brief reflection is prompted by one of the readings available for use at the liturgy of the 14th Sunday after Pentecost, proper 19, in accordance with the Revised Common Lectionary. The reading, Exodus chapter 32, verses 7 to 14. The Lord said to Moses, "Go down at once. Your people, whom you brought up out of the land of Egypt, have acted perversely. They have been quick to turn aside from the way that I commanded them. They have cast for themselves an image of a calf and have worshipped it and sacrificed to it and said, 'These are your gods, O Israel, who brought you up out of the land of Egypt.'" The Lord said to Moses, "I have seen this people, how stiff-necked they are. Now let me alone so that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation." But Moses implored the Lord, his God, and said, "O Lord, why does your wrath burn hot against your people, whom you brought out of the land of Egypt with great power and with a mighty hand? Why should the Egyptians say, 'It was with evil intent that he brought them out to kill them on the mountains and to consume them from the face of the earth'? Turn from your fierce wrath, change your mind, and do not bring disaster on your people. Remember Abraham, Isaac, and Israel, your servants, how you swore to them by your own self, saying to them, 'I will multiply your descendants like the stars of heaven. And all this land that I have promised, I will give to your descendants, and they shall inherit it forever.' And the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he had planned to bring on his people." The end of the reading. In context, Moses, leader of the Israelites, had gone up on the mountain to commune with God and to receive instructions for establishing covenant worship and indeed procedures for ordering the life of the community. Moses spent 40 days and 40 nights on the mountain. During his absence, the people became impatient and anxious and spoke disrespectfully of Moses. In fact, they chose a new leader, Aaron, and demanded a tangible sign of God's presence and carried on with their lives. As for this Moses, they said, we do not know what has become of him. It is in that light that God said to Moses, go down at once and address this matter, and let me alone so that my wrath may burn hot against them and I may consume them, and of you I will make a great nation. In other words, leave me alone, let me mash them up, man. They have no behavior, they have no conduct. That is a word we used to get licks for, even though we didn't know what conduct meant. The parents said, you have no conduct, and they flogged you. And they said, next time, will you have some conduct? And you said, yes, you will have some conduct, even though you didn't know what conduct meant. But it was connected to licks. But Moses didn't move, you know. He held his ground and presented a compelling case. I didn't wish to use case, but given that we are the law term, he presented a compelling case to God for the people. His role has been described by the scholars of the scriptures as mediatory and intercessory. In the end, the Lord changed his mind about the disaster that he had planned to bring on his people. What advocacy at the highest court of existence? And God's wrath did not burn hot against the people, and he did not consume them. This story, brothers and sisters, calls attention to many aspects of our roles and responsibilities as members of a community, and in particular, as citizens, of this blessed nation. I make reference to our leadership roles and responsibilities in the many dimensions in which these roles apply. We have seen the challenges to leadership and of leadership across the world, as well as in our nation. And whether it is in Italy, Brazil, France, or Great Britain, the challenges to leadership and of leadership are momentous. So too in this republic, from the household to the school, to the church, to the community groups, and right up the ladder, the hierarchy of institutions, we have much work to do. So then, at this time, and on this auspicious occasion of reflection, as we enter a new term and arrange for a new beginning, the Exodus passage reminds us of certain leadership responsibilities that must accrue to us. In the first place, leaders must commune with God for renewal, inspiration, instruction, and vision. Remember, these are not new, these are reminders. Secondly, leaders possess a mediatory role by which they intercede for the people and strive for the best result for them in the circumstances. It is akin to Christ's mediatory role for the people of God in the heavenly place, and carries a messianic function which, when appropriately applied, brings change and new hope. In the third place, leaders provide guidance and admonition to their respective constituencies at every level. And finally, that leaders pursue the well-being of the people in a sacrificial and redeeming manner. It is in this context, and the context of the above, that these reminders have been given, and that I call upon all citizens to fulfill their leadership roles at their respective positions. And I ask the judiciary respectfully to take the lead in allowing justice to roll down like waters and righteousness like an ever-flowing stream. May God bless us all as we seek his grace and pursue his will in making this land a just and righteous land for all his people. Amen.
Can help somebody as I pass along. If I can help somebody with a word or song. If I can show somebody he is traveling wrong, then my living shall not be in vain. Then my living shall not be in vain. And my living shall not be in vain. If I can help somebody as I pass along, then my living shall not be in vain. If I can do my duty as a good man ought, if I can bring back beauty to a world abroad, if I can spread love's message as the master taught, then my living shall not be in vain. Then my living shall not be in vain.
We now welcome to the podium our feature speaker today, the Professor Rosemary Bell Antwine, Dean of the Faculty of Law of the University of the West Indies. Welcome, madam.
Good morning. In a year that brought us a migrant crisis, earthquakes, raging floods, the vivid demonstration of climate change in Hurricane Dorian, and even promises for cannabis marijuana reform, it is apparent that the world as we know it has changed. So this year's theme, Transformation for Enhanced Delivery, is indeed timely. The worlds in which courts and lawyers operate are also changing, increasing the parameters of justice, whether it be cybercrime, cryptocurrencies, virtual reality, LGBT issues, bullying, gangs, or cricket. Just this week, the Ministry of Labor held a consultation to propose new laws on migrant workers, finally accepting that we can no longer bury our heads in the sand with regard to the thousands of migrant neighbors on our shores. More and more, the public calls upon the legal system to find solutions for emerging and enduring problems. Every time disaster strikes, I worry that I should have been a doctor or an engineer or even a construction worker so I could directly intervene. Where is the lawyer, judge, magistrate in all of this? At times, law can seem esoteric, at least our modern understanding of law. But scratch below the surface and see how lawyering is vital here too. The breakdown of law and order, looting, building codes, insurance, etc., all rely on law. Soon, as we saw in Bermuda after their hurricane, sophisticated issues of land reform and ownership will emerge, challenging the very status quo so carefully constructed over hundreds of years and requiring innovative responses for a changed landscape. It is not that we here in Trinidad and Tobago are standing still, not at all. The objective observer can hardly avoid noticing the deep and several changes in our judicial system in very recent times. New courts, new processes, and cutting-edge technological advances. These are indeed very impressive. We have seen the much-needed operationalization of children's courts, bringing to bear the social objectives of rehabilitation and care, particularly to our vulnerable children, that we have long paid only lip service to. It also insulated such children from the harsh realities of the magistrate's courts and had the additional advantage of lessening the overload there. We even now have traffic courts, a welcome development. We have seen a new online cutting-edge court case management system, the Trinidad and Tobago Judicial Information Management System, TTJIM. Among other things, it facilitates searches and creates case information on cases for all of the courts. The development of court pay, making payments easier through an online electronic payment system, is also a welcome initiative. This is an example of process reform aimed at increasing efficiency and service delivery, as well as improving safety, accessibility, and convenience. The introduction of online probate searches should also be mentioned. I am pleased to see that TTJIM is currently being developed further for expansion into the magistrate's court and is being rolled out to the magistracy in phases, beginning with the criminal and traffic jurisdiction. Regrettably, the magistracy has far too often been seen as the poor cousin in the judiciary, whereas, in fact, it is the fulcrum of justice. The vast majority of persons who treat with the judicial system will do so through the magistracy. If we are serious about access and equality in our justice system, it is incumbent upon us to put in place radical reforms to the magistracy. Justice should really not be measured by dollars and cents. The dignity of obtaining redress and being heard abounds whether it is $100 or $1 million, particularly for a poor man or woman accustomed to being marginalized in our class-based societies. We are all familiar with the issues that affect the magistrate's court's performance. Poorly designed information systems, lack of a customer focus, a reliance of manual procedures despite the excessive volume of cases, lack of standard or efficient procedures, particularly in data, overload, and of course, resource constraints. Access to justice is not prioritized. Justice is slow and unwieldy, all of which cause frustration and alienation to those who seek redress. I have no doubt that TT Jim will improve the magistracy's ability to supervise time and events from the beginning of cases to their finalization. Automated case flow will provide crucial information to trace and track cases. More importantly, it introduces accountability within our judicial system, something which the public has been clamoring for. Performance can be measured with regard to timeliness, equality, independence, and fairness. Such accountability can go a long way to secure integrity, expand access to justice, and help build much-needed public trust and confidence in the system. It is time to bring the magistracy's antiquated system into the 21st century, to better meet the challenges of contemporary society and to ensure that it is front and center of our judicial system. Perhaps most impactful from the public's point of view, however, is the recent initiative undertaken to address the backlog of criminal cases in the criminal courts. Not only did the judges of the criminal court dispose of several matters by trial or plea, but the change resulted in hundreds of persons coming to court for status hearings, maximum sentence indications, and case management directions, making an important dent in the backlog plaguing the system. The maximum sentence hearings and bail monitoring program and status hearings is an example of a transforming initiative that returns sanctity to the judicial system. These initiatives will surely go a long way to meet the challenges of the implementation deficit and an under-resourced judiciary and JLSC so often lamented about. The focus on specialization in our courts is also an important reform. The progress made with the Children's Court and legislation on children is nothing short of remarkable and addresses a dire and somewhat shameful social malaise with regard to how this society treats its children. I look forward to seeing meaningful statistics from these courts, an often overlooked component in our administration of justice. These should be stratified by race, gender, disability, and socioeconomic background, to name a few, so that we can begin to understand what is truly happening with our nation's children who fall off the grid. Many years ago, I did a consultancy for UNICEF in Barbados and was amazed simply by speaking to officials to learn of a discernible link between so-called juvenile delinquency and dyslexia and other learning disabilities. As far as I'm aware, this has never been interrogated in a systematic way, and it will certainly require appropriate data, which we can now provide if there is a foresight to do so. Socioeconomic questions are also clearly relevant to this issue. As a labor lawyer, I look forward to hearing more about the industrial court, though I recognize, of course, its autonomy. I do not for one moment accept that the court is too skewed in favor of workers, but undoubtedly the industrial relations climate has deteriorated in Trinidad and Tobago. Moreover, the very place of unions and workers' rights is being quite amazingly questioned today. Recently, I heard a poll asking if we still need unions. We have traversed very far from the gains of Tubali Raya Buzz Butler and seem to have forgotten the lessons of the past. I believe the industrial court now has an important educative function today and cannot only focus on its purely judicial role. In sum, transformation demands more than procedural and technological advances. We are at a juncture where the substantive tenets of the law and the judicial system are at risk. There is still so much more work to do despite these excellent right steps. Next week, my faculty will lead a delegation to present a hearing before the Inter-American Commission on Human Rights on remand issues, particularly as they apply to women on remand who have been arrested for murder, but who were in fact victims of domestic violence and who now languish in our jails, some for more than 10 years. There are many other troubling issues that we must confront. So we are in the middle of an unfinished journey in transformation. I acknowledge fully that trying to lead transformation is a difficult exercise, and sometimes we are tempted to kill the messenger. It is much easier to remain in comfortable cocoons, particularly where change will disturb our bread and butter. Many of us remain entrenched in traditional ways of doing things that may no longer be suited to present-day realities. More importantly, however, I underscore that despite all of these impressive initiatives, there will only be genuine transformation if each one of us does his or her part. True transformation requires collective responsibility. It is necessary, but not sufficient, to look to the state and judicial administrators to drive change. Improved technology and procedural mechanisms certainly provide an excellent platform for improved efficiencies, but they will come to naught if we still take on more cases than we can handle, if we engage in unnecessary adjournments, if we settle cases without appropriate consultations with clients and which cover only our costs and little else, and the list can go on. I'm sorry. In this society, we have a tendency to believe that lack of ethical standards are restricted to financial impropriety or tangible benefits. Not so. All of the above inappropriate conduct bring into play ethics. I have always believed that as legal practitioners, we have a duty to spearhead transformation, not just to make systems more efficient, but in ways that bring about change that will uplift our societies. In this hallowed and sacred space, I also think about our craft and how it squares with our spiritual purpose. In preparing for this address, this led me inevitably, perhaps, to the Bible, only because I'm a Christian and more familiar with it, but just as easily we could look to the Quran and other holy books. Not surprisingly, lawyers and tax collectors are among the most criticized persons in the holy book. In Luke 11, Jesus was explaining that the second greatest law was, love your neighbor as yourself. Said, and you experts in the law, woe to you because you load people down with burdens they can hardly carry, and you yourselves did not lift one finger to help them. Therefore, this generation will be held responsible for the blood of all the prophets that has been shed since the beginning of the world. Woe to you experts in the law because you have taken away the key to knowledge. You yourselves have not entered and you have hindered those who were entering. Sobering words. But how do we enter that sacrosanct space? How do we locate that noble mission that we are called upon to initiate? How can we engage in the collective engagement that will bring about real transformation to our societies? It is true that in those times, the lawyers were not as we know them today, but religious leaders who instructed on the faith. Indeed, the Quran is still the source of Islamic law and faith, so lawyers have an indispensable role in defining the path of a Muslim. So from time immemorial, the law and lawyers were intricately bound up with defining that roadmap for spirituality and goodness, seeing these as instrumental in the lawyering and judicial functions. I believe that some of that calling remains, if only we can harness it. Like many of you, perhaps, I myself constantly struggle with my own sense of purpose. Every day I wake, I ask for direction to locate the ways in which my career path can be meaningful to the collective whole. Whether judicial system or individual practitioner, perhaps we need to constantly remind ourselves of our true roles as upholders and shapers of the law. So yes, these judicial reforms are indispensable changes, which will go a long way to correct the harsh inequities and inefficiencies of the system. Yet, I ask for more if we are to have true transformation. Our laws and justice system remain alienating and inaccessible. There is a large degree of mistrust, cynicism, and lack of confidence in the administration of justice. Many also believe that the justice system is inherently biased towards those who have, while the have-nots are lost in the system. Whether we are speaking of bail or remand or children or sentences, the accusation is the same. Real transformation requires that we address this. There is need for a paradigm shift towards a system that is genuinely caring and offers solutions that are relevant to people's lives that can make a difference. We must also find a way to engage the public with the justice system, where the masses interact with the judicial system, assured in the knowledge that it is focused on their needs. These are not easy tasks and requires the kind of transformation that is grounded in attitudinal shifts and philosophical grounding. Justice must also reach those it seeks to serve. Currently in Trinidad and Tobago, lawyers' fees are too high, in my humble opinion. As a Caribbean woman, I am conscious that they are among the highest, if not the highest, than anywhere else in the Caribbean. I wonder this is partly because, although there has been a fused profession for over three decades, we are still clinging on to the division, instructing attorneys and so on, resulting in two sets of fees, which is not necessarily the case anywhere else in the region. Lawyers' fees are directly related to the quality of our justice system and how the citizenry can participate in it. Is it time, for example, for contingency fees? We all think that we deserve high fees and high status because, after all, we studied hard. We deserve it. However, our ability to demand such an elevated place in society came at a social cost. Our successes are not only because of our individual merit, but bears a direct relationship to the sacrifices that the society made on our behalf. Student loans, GATE, and collective decisions by the state all played a part in our legal education. Not long ago, only the very wealthy could become attorneys. It is still that way in many countries. Should the spoils be for us alone? There are many ordinary citizens out there who also have the right to be heard, the right to participate and obtain a remedy in our judicial system based on the merit of their cases, but they are prohibited from doing so simply because it is too expensive. We should cultivate not an individualistic perspective, but a life's work consciousness that we all have a part to play in improving the social malaise we find ourselves in. Access to justice is therefore not merely about the state ensuring that there are more judges and resources and technology and procedural mechanisms. It is a collective responsibility. We all have a part to play in that goal. Both procedural and substantive amendments to laws are necessary in this endeavor. Of course, this should also mean stimulating avenues for stakeholders in the justice system to be able to engage fully right up to the appeal level where warranted. Procedural obstacles and high fees would be counterproductive to this objective. It is recognized too that our common law system is premised on inherent conflict and a penchant to win at all costs, which does not augur well for a collective will to bring about true transformation. It is an impulse that we must constantly resist. The social purpose of the lawyer, the judge, the police officer, the court official must be toward a commitment to working towards improving and reforming the system. If we do not continually work towards reform, the system will become meaningless and even harmful. We can ill afford to be comfortable observers sitting on the fence. Moreover, legal practitioners and judges may fail to see the larger picture if bogged down in legal technicalities and a too pedantic approach to lawyering. I have spoken elsewhere of the rule of law, as opposed to the more barren ruling by laws. Today, the attorney, the judge, must have deep understandings of the nuances and sophisticated concepts that are relevant to our society and which must underpin lawyering and judicial making. Whether these be diversity, inequalities in the justice system, citizen insecurity, disability, and the like. These are important lessons, in particular for the criminal justice system, corrupted often by delay and profit, which prioritize rich man's justice. These issues are compounded by the apathy that attends the increasing undermining of rights disproportionately against the already marginalized because of citizen insecurity in the face of crime. I am not suggesting that we should go out there and be Miss Pollyanna do good, but I sincerely believe that there is a minimum irreducible core of lawyering that dictates that we become fully engaged for the common good. Throughout history, legal reform has underpinned every great social transformation and often spearheaded it. And we can either be casual onlookers until we are jolted in reality, or work with a collective spirit to shape the society we want to live in. In this year's Distinguished Jurist Lecture by the President of Howard University, I was struck by the reminder that it was the lawyers and judges of the time, buoyed by a strong social commitment to equality and justice, who systematically fought for change by bringing legal challenges to the unjust paradigm of racism. This ultimately brought about law reform, casting out discriminatory laws, resulting in the Civil Rights Act. Far too often, we see law and lawyering and the justice system as simply reactive. We respond to problems as they arise. Perhaps this is the inevitable fallout from a common law system that grew up in an ad hoc manner as issues arose to be determined by the chancellor. This is in direct contrast to the civil law systems, where law is proactive and designed to meet deeply thought out philosophical values and ideals, such as equality and liberty. But in a world which now constantly challenges so many of our deeply held beliefs and assumptions, perhaps the time is now to take a different approach. At its core, our judicial system must be a humanizing and equalizing force in society. It must be able to reach and understand our reality, imbued as it is with its own peculiar historical and social circumstances. And despite the challenges of constant flux, even the sustainable development goals presume that law and human rights are at the heart of social development and transformation. Are we to be architects of law and justice, helping to build the societies we want and deserve, or mere technicians, plying our trade with a dispassionate expertise and no thought for the bigger picture? One of my favorite mantras comes from the first black president of Howard University, Mordecai Wyatt Johnson, who said, "A lawyer is either a social engineer or he is a parasite on society." Which are you? Will you be part of the transformation that has begun? Thank you.
Here comes a wave meant to wash me away, a tide that is taking me under. Swallowing sands left with nothing to say, my voice drowned out under thunder. But I won't cry, I won't start to crumble. Whenever they try to shut me or cut me, stone, every rule, every word, centuries old and unbending. Stay in your place, better seen and not heard. Well, now that story is ending. Cause I cannot start to crumble. So come on and try, try to shut me or cut me. Try it. All I know is I won't go.
prayers of intercessions for our President, Prime Minister, and all those who serve as political authorities, that God our Father continue to guide them in their decisions, so that they may lead us in the way of development towards a higher level of nationhood, and demonstrate by their own examples their individual commitment to our nation's motto. Together we aspire, together we achieve. Lord, in your mercy.
For the Chief Justice and other judges, masters, magistrates, registers, justices of the peace, and all those associated with them in the administration of justice, that they may receive divine guidance from Almighty God to serve the people efficiently and impartially, so that justice may not only be done, but may also seen to be done. Om Shantihi, Shantihi, Shantihi.
For the families of our nation, immediate and extended, that they may communicate effectively and receive and instill those holy and eternal values ordained by our Creator, that shall bring to bear blessings upon themselves and the nation. Our Lord, hear us. Amen.
For all those who work in the protective and social services of our nation, that their efforts may be characterized by integrity, devotion, and self-sacrifice, and be duly appreciated by those whom they serve, and in protecting us, they themselves may be protected against the forces of destruction and lawlessness. Ashe, ashe, ashe.
For the sick and the afflicted in our midst, that God in his wisdom will restore all mind and body to perfection, while giving his strength and courage for all we have to do, that we will ever be mindful of his presence within and around us, that the promise of peace, health, eternal happiness, and harmony shall be ours. Let us pray to the Lord.
For the spiritual leaders, that God will give them divine guidance and strength to live the life and to work tirelessly and effectively toward the fulfillment of their duties and responsibilities to the citizens of the nation. Lord, in your mercy.
Let us pray. Go out into the world in peace. Be of good courage. Hold fast that which is good. Never pay back wrong with wrong. Strengthen the faint-hearted. Support the weak. Help the afflicted. Love one another. Love and serve God in the power of the Holy Spirit. And the blessing of God Almighty upon you this day, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you now and forever. Amen. The recessional.
Undergo many trials and tests to make sure when I step into this world I'll be a blessing. So move out of my way, I'm coming through. But if you want to come along, you know what to do. Cause you're right in Chimango, Messiah. For me, my way to positive vibe. Let me go, I bust in the roof so I can reach for what is mine. No matter what life brings on the road, I'm gonna reach for what is mine. Let them talk, talk what they want, gonna reach for what is mine.
Nobody gonna bring me down below, I'm gonna reach for what is mine.
Everyone has a place
in this world, a purpose for the soul, a vision to be. You got to open your eyes and believe. Not all people say, don't move the dictator. Cause they're riding Jimbego,
Messiah, for people with a positive vibe. Let me go, I bust in the roof so I can reach for what is mine.
No matter what life brings on the road, I'm gonna reach for what is mine.
Let them talk, talk all they want, gonna reach for what is mine.
Nobody gonna bring me down below, I'm gonna reach for what is mine. To the top of the mountain,
I'm gonna reach.
Over hills and valleys too,
I'm gonna
reach. Making my dreams come true,
I'm gonna reach.
Yeah.
I'm gonna reach.
Oh.
I'm gonna reach.
With every step I climb,
I'm gonna reach.
And with God on my side,
I'm
gonna reach the stars this time.
I'm gonna reach.
Yeah.
I'm gonna reach.
Oh. Long before I ever came into existence, my mother belly rested. This fetus was destined to undergo many trials and tests. To make sure when I step into this world, I be a blessing. So move out of my way, I'm coming through. But if you want to come along, you know what to do. Cause you're riding Jamaica, I'm inside. For people with a positive vibe. Let me go, I was in the road so I can reach for what is mine. No matter what life brings on the road, I'm gonna reach for what is mine. Let them talk, talk all they want's gonna reach for what is mine. Nobody gonna bring me down below, I'm gonna reach for what is mine. To the top of the mountain, over hills and valleys too, making my dreams come true.
Hey,
oh. With every step I climb, and with God on my side, I'm gonna reach the stars this time.